This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: A Successful Shadow by Old Sleuth. Prologue. Those of our readers who read our narrative, Two Wonderful Detectives, will more especially enjoy the further adventures of Jack Alvarez. To those who did not read that narrative, we will state that this remarkable detective had just solved a great mystery, one of the most remarkable detective feats ever accomplished. He had found that there had been a true heir to a great fortune which had been deposited in a most mysterious manner with a banker. But alas, when his shadow appeared successful in one direction, he encountered a little tombstone in an out-of-the-way graveyard, which appeared to settle beyond all dispute that the heiress had died when a child, and the great fortune which she would have inherited was diverted in another direction. Indeed, through a singular combination of circumstances, the detective himself became heir to a portion of the great estate. He did not feel disposed, however, to accept the benefice, and made up his mind that there were actual heirs living who were through kinship entitled to the fortune. He had started out on a former shadow, without a clue, and in his resolve to find the collateral heirs, he also started out minus a single clue. But he was a man, as our readers know, to discover clues, and in a most remarkable manner he succeeded through a series of thrilling adventures in finding a legitimate heir to an immense estate. End of the prologue. Chapter I. The same old incident of a missing beauty, a widow's narrative, and aroused interest, the possibilities in a name, startling suggestions, was it a clue? Mr. Alvarez, I am very poor. I cannot offer you a large reward, but I have saved a few $100s, and those I will give you if you are successful in finding my lost child. Jack Alvarez, the detective, was seated in his office when a veiled woman entered and addressed him in the language with which we open our narrative. The detective was a kind-hearted man, well-to-do financially, and as it occurred not immediately engaged on any special job. He looked the visitor over a moment, and then said, "Madam, before I can entertain your proposition at all, I must see your face." "Is that necessary, sir?"
"It is."
"I am sorry."
"Why?"
"Simply because I fear that you will be so shocked, you will not aid me."
"Why will I be shocked, madam?
Are you a criminal?"
"I am an honest woman, sir, but oh, how bitter has been my life."
"Yes, sir, it has been one of humiliation and suffering, and now there has come to me this terrible sorrow. It may prove even a greater sorrow than I at present dare anticipate, but I trust not."
"You need not fear to show me your face."
"May I first tell you my story, sir?"
"Yes."
"I was left an orphan at a very early age. I was reared in an institution until I was able to go out to work. I never knew my parents, I never knew my real name. I was deserted in my infancy, and I grew up to be quite a fair-looking girl. I can say this now, sir, without any feeling of exultation, for what beauty I may once have possessed vanished in one night, and I am now hideous to look at. When I left the asylum in which I had been placed, I went to live with a very kind family, and at the age of 20 I married a poor but very worthy man. My little daughter was 5 years old when one night our little family was aroused by the barking of our dog. We lived up in the country in New York State. My husband was an invalid and slept in a room adjoining the one I occupied with my child. As I told you, I was aroused by the barking of our dog. I knew it meant danger, and I leaped from my bed and instantly discovered that our little home was on fire. I rushed down the one flight of stairs with my child in my arms, and then returned to aid my husband to escape, but alas! I was overcome by smoke and flame, and fell unconscious, and would have been consumed had not a neighbor rushed in and dragged me forth. I was saved. But when the fire was subdued and they entered the room of my husband, they found him dead. He had been suffocated, and I, alas, was horribly disfigured for life, being terribly burned in the face. This, sir, is a part of my story. I am terribly scarred,
and now if you still desire to see my face, I will remove my veil before continuing my story. Madam, you need not be ashamed to remove your veil. Your scars were honorably won, you should be proud, yes, I will look upon your face. The woman removed her veil, and indeed she did have two ghastly-looking scars, but she had exaggerated her disfigurement, for despite the scars, hers was not an uncomely face to look upon. Her eyes were beautiful, and the detective was led to say with chivalrous truth and gallantry, "Madam, you may once have been so beautiful, oversensitiveness causes you to exaggerate your misfortune, but enough, tell me your story. Tell me about the loss of your child." The woman's voice was very musical. She spoke in low tones, and her pronunciation and general demeanor betrayed the fact that gentle blood ran in her veins. "As I told you, sir, my husband was suffocated, and I was left a widow with one little child, a daughter. I will not dwell upon my sorrow, but kindly permit me to say that the horror of that catastrophe has never passed from my mind, and I have been a sad woman, and now, alas, it appears as though a greater sorrow were about to overwhelm me. Not if I can aid you, madam. It is refreshing and gladdening to hear you say so. I had been told that you were a wonderful and very kind man, and a hero whom anyone could trust. I need the services of a brave, discerning man. And if I can serve you, madam, I will continue your narrative. After the death of my husband, I removed with my infant daughter to New York City, as it was necessary that I should earn a living for my child. I was ambitious to give my daughter a good education, yes, give her opportunities that were never vouchsafed her mother. I was a very skillful needlewoman, and taking cheap apartments, I applied for work at some of the large stores, and my skill soon secured me employment, and I continued to live economically in order to save money to educate my child, and sir, I succeeded. I worked steadily, and was always successful in securing work, for as I have said, I was a very expert needlewoman, and so the years sped by until my child became 16, and sir, I can say that she was indeed splendidly equipped as far as education is concerned. I intended that she should become a governess, and thus be surrounded by environments in line with her education and refined tastes. She was always a dutiful and loving daughter, cheerful where I was sad, hopeful where I was despondent. 1 year ago, my daughter became appointed as governess in a well-known family, and they treated her in the kindest manner, and became very much attached to her. Indeed, they treated her more as an equal than as an employee. As I have said, my daughter is not only very beautiful but splendidly educated, and during her residence with the family I have named, she met among their guests a young German who claims to be a baron. This young baron fell in love with her, and from what information I can obtain, his love, or pretended love, was not reciprocated by my child, and now comes the mystery. One day my daughter went out to do a little shopping. She has not been seen by any of her friends since, and I am almost distracted with apprehension. She is very beautiful, as I've said, and I felt that she was perfectly safe while living with the family where she was employed. I was told by a person with whom I am acquainted that I should put the affair in the hands of a detective at once, and I was referred to you. And who referred you to me, madam? The visitor mentioned the name of a person whom our hero knew well, and after a moment's meditation, the detective demanded, "How long has your daughter been missing?" "It's now nearly a week since she went forth and failed to return." "And what is the name of this baron?" "He is known as August Wagner. He claims that is but an assumed name, and that he is really a baron and heir to great estates in Germany." "Did your daughter ever speak to you about this young man?"
"Yes."
"And did she show any indication to look favorably upon his professions of attachment?"
"On the contrary, she showed the utmost aversion to him, and it is possible that because of her aversion she has run away and hidden herself so as to escape his attentions, or it is possible he has persuaded her to elope with him. Her friends favor the latter idea. By her friends, you mean the family with whom she resided?
Yes.
They are favorable to the Baron?
They appear to be, and strangely, since my daughter's disappearance, they have turned against her.
Against your daughter?
Yes.
Where is the Baron?
He is still a visitor at the Richards' home.
Richards is the name of the family with whom you resided.
Yes.
And they still entertain the Baron?
Yes.
Have you seen the Baron?
I have.
And what does he say?
He says he knows nothing about my daughter.
And he claimed to have loved her?
Yes.
Does he exhibit any sorrow or anxiety?
He does not, and this to me appears very significant.
The detective was thoughtful. He recognized that indeed the Baron's sudden indifference was significant.
He has not offered to aid you in finding her.
He has not.
And the Richards family, do they exhibit any anxiety?
They do not.
This Baron is their intimate friend.
He appears to be.
And they suggest that he knows where she is?
Not exactly. They merely declare that my daughter was not abducted, that wherever she is, her absence is voluntary.
And the Richards family appear to have turned against your daughter?
Yes.
And previously, they were very fond of her.
Yes, apparently.
The apparent change has come since her disappearance?
Yes.
Madam, I will undertake this case.
What is your daughter's name?
Emily Spear.
The detective gave a start, and we will here explain the cause.
Emily was the name of the heiress to the fortune, which he at that moment held in trust.
Ordinarily, there would not be much significance in two persons having the same given name, but our hero was a man subject to wonderful discernments, a man who builded on the slightest incident, and from that instant he had more than an ordinary interest in the missing Emily Spear, and that interest within a few hours was to grow into a thrilling intensity under later very singular coincident discoveries.
End of the chapter.
Chapter 2. A most singular and wonderful coincidence, the detective strikes a new trail, a denouement most wonderful possibilities and probabilities beyond peradventure.
And your name?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.